Hey twins, we are here at the Indianapolis Black Expo. It is Saturday the 15th and it's about like 1:15. And we just got here, you know, we just walking around. My sister's looking at some earrings and chokers. It's, you know, it's nice. It's a annual event we have here every year at Indianapolis. So yeah, we're gonna check it out. We see a lot of friends and family down here. And it's like 11:26 in the morning. I'm here with my mom. She's at the eye doctor. She's inside. I'm outside because it's like cold as shit in there. But yeah, this weekend is about to be fun filled and lit. No, I'm just playing. But it's gonna be fun filled. So you guys know Girls Trip came out last night. Well, yesterday, a lot of people went yesterday. I'm going Sunday with a group of girls, and I might go again sometime this week. But today, we're going to a couple stores, running a little errands, and that's about it. And link back up with my sister after she get her hair done. She's getting Goddess Folox or just Folox. We'll see later. But she's right now getting her done, and my mom's inside the eye doctor here in Indianapolis. But yeah, just came out here, you know, check in with you guys, and it's been a long time. Now this vlog is gonna be all over the place because it's different weeks in one vlog. So you have, I think, part of my vacation, the Cincinnati Expo, and some other things. But yeah, we finna be black back on the vlog thing, twins. And like, comment below if you want me to start doing like challenge videos and other different videos. So I want to hear feedback from you guys. So, yeah, that's about it. I'm quit rambling now. I'll come to you when we're done leaving. We're done and we're about to leave the eye doctor. And we're on to the next thing. Bye. Hey, twins. It is Sunday and it's about 5:45. Sorry I'm coming on here so late. I just left the movies. I went to go see Girls Trip. And then I went out to eat with the group of girls that I went out with. Now I'm going to drop my car off at home and go get in the car with my mother. Because we are going to go to the store because my little cousin is going out of town for the first time by herself. And she's only 11, y'all. So time flies. But she will be back Wednesday night. So she's just going for 3 days. So she's going on a college tour, so you can never start too early. So they're going to HBCU college tour, so I'm very proud of her, because with the group of kids that are going, you have to prove that you're ready to go out of town, and you have to prove that you're ready to go on this college tour. So I commend her for doing what she needed to do. how well behaved she was doing, like, so she can go on this college tour. So yeah. And yeah, I'm very proud of her. We'll see her later in this video. So yeah, what you guys been up to today? I know you guys gonna see come up after the fact. Comment below how you guys this weekend has been going, how your summer's been panning out. Because for us in the city that I live in, most kids go, some townships go back to school on the 28th of July, and the rest go back in August, the first week in August, maybe the middle of August or the end of August. But you know, school's coming up, gotta get those school supplies going. And I go back to class, I start back my classes in the middle of August, in the middle of work and working out and doing all that I need to do to get myself ready for work and school. So yep, I will talk to you guys after I drop my car off and get in the car with my mother.
When we talked about doing this event, he jumped right in head first. So I'm not gonna steal your thunder, man. Why don't you give everybody kind of an intro of who you are and what you do for a living?
Well, I appreciate it, man. Great vision by you and Jay and Brent. I didn't know Brent was on this. We sit on the board together. Hey, let's go Brent back in the back, man. What's up, brother? My name is Andre Hogue. I own some financial brokerages here in Manhattan, New York. Been in the financial world for about 17 years, really focusing on short-term, long-term investments, 401k strategies, debt elimination, all of that good stuff. I guess enough about that. I've been an entrepreneur for a while, multiple areas. So I'm excited to have this conversation.
Awesome, awesome. So, I mean, you've heard the album, you're a hip hop head. When you think about the story of OJ, you listen to it, you see the videos, what are your initial thoughts? Where does it take you? What would you share from your perspective and the experience that you've had as a professional?
One, you don't have to negotiate who you are to be successful. I think we all seen that with OJ. He thought that not being black would make him more successful. And I would tell you personally, and just knowing that's not the case, you gotta be who you are 100%. Because people can tell a phony from a mile away. And we all saw OJ as that, regardless of what you thought the outcome should have been. We all had an opinion of what his character was. So I thought that was a pretty interesting way of saying that. You're gonna be black either way, and embrace that. America is really better because of African Americans being here. So it's a beautiful thing.
Excellent, excellent. I think it's interesting to find out the album officially came out on the 30th, so like just a couple of days ago. And I think from the initial pre-orders and the listens, hearing the song, the story of OJ, and then OJ coming out of jail right around that same time seemed interesting. What's your take on that, having to do marketing and advertising and leveraging things that are going on to your advantage? Do you think that that was intentional, or is that just kind of a luck of the draw when you get to have a song called The Story of OJ and then this figure gets out of jail at the same time?
I guess let me make sure I understand your question. You're saying, is that a benefit to Jay or is that a benefit to OJ?
Well, I hope it's a benefit to both of them, but specifically around the idea that assuming Jay-Z could have known, does it make sense to you from an entrepreneur professional's perspective to leverage that opportunity to potentially increase sales?
I don't think OJ can bring Jay-Z value, in my personal opinion. I don't think his sales are gonna go up because OJ's out. OJ became relevant again after he got out. But the fact that he spent 9 years in jail, for some people probably would have been out on, kind of lets you know what America thinks of him. So I don't think that Jay-Z was going to sell either way, because he's just got the value. But I don't think OJ probably even benefits from it. You know, in my personal and professional opinion, I don't know how. I mean, he's going to try to probably find some way to market, but the song itself, I don't think it's gonna make him a ton of money.
Interesting. Okay, so let's jump into some of these lyrics. The first thing that stood out to me, he said, I could have bought a place in Dumbo for like $2 million. That same place today is worth $25 million. Guess how I'm feeling? Dumbo. So a couple of things jumped out to me there. And the first one is really around real estate. In your opinion and what you've seen, is real estate a good investment, a sound strategy for people to build wealth on today?
It is, and it's going to always be a good strategy because God's not making more land. It just is what it is, okay? So you got to, the biggest challenge is not getting in something or not. It's you got to measure your risk tolerance. Most people are what's considered in the investment world risk adverse.
What do you mean by risk tolerance? Okay. Break that down for
me. Yeah, so if you're risk adverse, that means you're scared to take risk. That's your number one problem. It doesn't matter what I throw at you as an investment strategy. Scared money can't make money, okay? So, and most people are scared because they don't understand what game they're playing. You can't win a game you don't know the rules to. So you really got to understand part of making money is taking risk, all right? So real estate, 2008, I think, was part of the question. We saw that coming. It was predictable. The bottom out of the market came because of greed. There are two things that move the markets, investment markets, greed and fear. Whether you're investing in mutual funds or whatever it is, that's usually what drives it. So can you make money in real estate? Absolutely. And I would challenge you to have that as part of your portfolio. It shouldn't be all of it. But I mean, the days of flipping houses and making a bunch of money, that game has changed slightly. I'm not saying you can't do that, but you can buy a house in the suburbs. You don't have to go in Hallville, where I grew up, to flip a house anymore, okay? I mean, you can go and get a nice house in the suburbs. So real estate, absolutely, you can do that. But the biggest thing I want to challenge you is don't be scared to make money. And don't be scared to lose money, okay? I mean, when 2008 hit, I can't tell y'all how many people pulled their money out of the market and got killed on taxes, okay? I don't know what's going to happen. This is a kind of a rule of thumb. Every 8 to 10 years, there's going to be a recession, okay? And so when it comes to investments, this is the only industry I know when stuff go on sale, people run from it.
What do you mean? When stuff go on sale?
Okay. Listen, so miss that. So you ask yourself, listen, am I paying, am I saving anything on a monthly basis? And if I'm not, why not? There's one or two reasons. Either I got a discipline issue or the place I work doesn't work. Okay, now Jay said something in there. He said, y'all still taking advances. Did y'all catch that? He said, well, me and mine are doing what? Taking real chances. What he's talking about is the entrepreneur. See, the employee needs that check every 2 weeks. Okay? As long as you need other people to feed you, you ain't gonna never have enough money. See, the lion in the wild gotta go kill. The lion in the zoo is like the employee. They get fed every so often, but you just gotta make it do what it gotta do. If you really want more money, figure out your gift and go and invest in that so it can start generating you more cash. All right, did I answer that for you, brother? All right, ma'am, did you have one?
Okay. Yes, I had a question concerning credit. Like you hear like the Dave Ramsey version that credit isn't important, so you should work on, credit's not that big of a deal. And then you hear otherwise where you should focus on credit. So in your opinion, like, how important is our credit, or what should our focus be concerning that, if that makes sense?
It does. One, pay your bills, okay? If somebody gave it to you, pay it back. Okay, that's rule number one. Because all of us would treat one another that way, whether we're a lender or just a friend. Like if I done gave you $1,000 four times and you never paid me back, your credit is bad now and you still need that, right? So pay the bills as it relates to that. It is important though. It is important. And let me just share this from an African American perspective. You guys understand, particularly if you want to be an entrepreneur. It's a lot easier to get a car loan, a student loan, and a mortgage than it is to get a business loan. Okay? It just is what it is. All right? You got to be in a position to where you're trustworthy. And the way a person does anything is how they do everything. Okay? So when they lack discipline in multiple areas. And most people don't care enough to ask you a lot of questions. They just kind of want to know what they want to know. will you pay it back? So yes, now you will get to a position where maybe you're financially independent and you don't need it as much, but as we're building wealth, we're gonna need access to dollars that may not be our dollars. You know, other people's money spend too, right? Any other questions? Try to come up with, in your own mind, what stands out to you as some of the more important notes. And if you have any questions while you're reading the lyrics, while you're hearing what he's saying, take your index card and write the questions down. And we want to look forward to hearing talk about those at the conclusion of the song, and then we'll get started with this next portion. One more time.
Started thinking about investing in companies in a fundamentally different way, and I'm now, I think, looking at Kim, which she'll know, I think we're invested.
Why do I keep on running away? which we really see from a woman's perspective, relationship, romantic relationship perspective. So it was good to hear him kind of deal with this relationship with Beyonce, which of course we know, if we pay attention to her music as well, that she's been planting these seeds of kind of infidelity and all these other things that they're going through in their marriage. So we have a marriage counselor who is she's an expert in marriage counseling, family therapy. But before we bring her to the stage, I kind of want to get y'all feedback first on this song. All right. So if y'all have any kind of initial thoughts on this particular track, I really kind of want to hear from the women's perspective, any representation of the beehive that may be present. Do y'all have any kind of thoughts on this song as it relates to Jay-Z and Beyonce and what we know of them? Don't be shy. Sure, Adrian.
Not a member of the beehive, but I was just gonna say, I think that every woman heard 444 and was like, wow, when we get the men in our lives to actually admit that stuff and to get their lives together and realize that it's absolutely okay to acknowledge that you haven't been amazing and that it's probably time for you to get that together so you can build a legacy and move forward.
There you go. Anybody else? Oh, yeah, another one?
Just to kind of piggyback off of what she said, that we can't handle what you've done because we already know what you've done. We're just waiting for you to admit out loud what you've done, and we have to be disappointed and we have to act upset because it's not right. But we've been waiting for the admission the entire time. So I think that it's honestly, it's great that this is a conversation because it's time that we as a people and as different genders just start being real with each other and knowing that on both sides we aren't perfect and we all have mess and we gotta accept that mess comes with being in relationship, and unless you're willing to deal with it and talk through it, it's not going to get clean.
Into it. So from that aspect of like, all right, so like, you know, women kind of have that understanding, like some craziness can go on with their relationship. Even without the male kind of expressing that, they kind of already know what's up, right? So, and then we see like kind of women who stay within relationships that they know that their man is out acting crazy or whatever. So from my perspective, like we talk about like quote unquote, who kind of stay within that relationship. But then you see people who, for me, who understand like the bigger picture and understand the purpose of that relationship. So for instance, Dr. King and Scott King, right? So we found out that Dr. King was a player out here, getting it in with all this one on the civil rights tour. And so we found out all that stuff that happened, but Mrs. King stayed in that relationship. And so for me, I feel like she understood that it was bigger than just them. It was a generation that was looking after them. It was a whole civil rights movement. And had she left Dr. King because of the activity that he was doing, the extracurricular activity, we probably wouldn't have the rights that we have today. So from that perspective, like, what do you think of women who stay within those relationships? From our perspective, may be deemed unhealthy, but to them, their relationship and what they mean is bigger. Like Jay-Z and Beyonce is bigger than just them. It represents a whole generation. So for her to stay within that, it was, although it may have been bad for her, it was good on our end. Like, do you have any thoughts on that?
Particularly as a black woman, if everybody ain't healthy, then nobody's winning.
Yeah.
And I think if do we stay together even though one of us, and neither party is perfect, we're not talking about perfection, but even though perhaps one of us is not getting our need for trust or security or fulfillment, do we stay together for the sake of the family, the children, the race? I mean, there are those larger questions. But I think,
those times are now back, it's now called Afrotech. Generational wealth, that's the key. My parents ain't have shit, so that shit started with me. My mom took a...
Come on, y'all, come on. Legacy. All right, that's what's up. How y'all doing? I'm Pastor Mark, I'm from Mount Carmel Church. I see some Mount Carmel people in the house. That's what's up, man. I'm glad that y'all came out. Y'all enjoying yourself so far? That's good, y'all look tired, they put me last, you know what I mean? I had to bring all this energy, but shout out to all the other presenters that came. I'm glad that you all decided to come out here tonight. As Jay-Z said, you could have been anywhere in the world, but you're here with me, and I appreciate that. So let's get into legacy. There's a couple things that I kind of want to touch on. I'm not privileged like my other presenters. I don't have an expert. I am the expert, right? No? Okay. I don't have anybody that's accompanying me, mainly because this particular song deals with a couple of things. It deals with family, it deals with finances at some level, it also deals with faith. And so it kind of wraps almost the entire album up. That's why it's the last song on the actual album. And so I wanted to kind of just talk a little bit about my journey. And how legacy is important to me as a person who's a young pastor and who's been in ministry for, it's actually 10 years today. Wow. 10 years today. Thank you. So there's a couple. Let me just tell you a little bit about myself. I'm originally from Baltimore, Maryland. I'm not from Indy. My wife and I, we've actually been here for a year. And so I'm new to nap, and y'all taking naps already on me. Y'all look tired. Please wake up. Y'all make me feel bad. I've only been here for a year, and as a result, I've been able to, you know, see a little bit of the city and kind of get acclimated. But I think this song, Legacy, talks about a number of things. So let me just back up and say a little bit about me. So again, I'm from Baltimore. I've been here now for a year. I started preaching 10 years ago. And I was 22 years old when I started. I'm now 32, I got called to ministry. I was at Morgan State University on the East Coast in Baltimore, Maryland. And then I started preaching like in the summer after I graduated undergrad. I don't know if I just wanted to preserve that preaching legacy until I finished my stuff in undergrad. You know, we had an undergrad. You want to get all that stuff out of your system before you start, you know, preaching the word and all of that, but it didn't work. Because then I went to Howard and I was in D.C. and that's a whole nother world, right? Amen. Shout out to D.C. So legacy, for me, it means a lot. I think that we all contribute to our own legacy in one facet or another. And for me, it started with education. At the age of 25, I was privileged to being a college professor at a university that my mother graduated from. My mom, first generation college student, the only one of her siblings to graduate college, and her son ends up being a professor at the school that she earned her degree. My mom, she was a divorcee. I was raised primarily in a single parent home. My dad was in my household for about 8 years, so I knew what it was like to not have a dad around during the most pivotal matriculation stage of a young man's development, and that's during your middle school years. Your formative years are just as important. I thank God for the time my dad wasn't there, but primarily I was raised by my mom. My mom has 23 nieces, so not only was I the only child, all of my cousins for the most part were women. So I have a very interesting development story because, you know, women raised me. I didn't have a dad around, and I heard our counselor talk earlier about how it's important to have healthy relationships around you. And it's funny because I don't disagree with that research at all. And I wouldn't say that I learned everything that I was supposed to learn about a healthy relationship, but I did learn how to treat a woman. And my wife is sitting here to my right, and that's why she sits next to me. Because I know how, yeah, amen. And so as a result, you know, I think that the matriculation process, right, being able to be, you know, raised by, for the most part, women. I had some really strong male role models in my life here and there, but nobody as consistent as my mom. And so again, 25 years old, I am a faculty member at a university in Baltimore City, and I was a college professor for 6 years, and so as a result, I was able to start my legacy, and my legacy begins with education. And so, you know, that being the case, you know, starting with education, and I think as I became more educated, I'm sure I got a lot of other educated folks in the room, it gave me an opportunity to, you know, kind of experience life kind of double over, right? Because I told you I had fun in undergrad, but it wasn't really too much fun. It really started in D.C. So you know, it was in Morgan, but then it was an undergrad. But then when I became a college professor, it was like I couldn't get out of school, right? I mean, you spend 12 years to graduate. Then I went back and did another 12 years in school. Then I spent another 6 years in school because I was a professor. I'm like, man, that's all I know school. But I got a chance to have so many conversations with other first-generation college students, right? And it blew my mind because I thought, okay, my mom was first generation, right? And then I became kind of second-generation college grad. But none of my other cousins really went to school. So I think about the time I get to college and finish grad school, and then I'm teaching college, I'm not expecting to still see first-generation college grads. The reality is 90% of my students were all still first-gen college grads. And so, how many of you all are college graduates in the room? By show of hands. Amen, man. Pat yourselves on the back. Give yourselves a hand for being college graduates without student loans. Okay. So good. I understand. So I want to kind of turn it over to you just to hear, and from you all's perspective, what is legacy? Like, if you had to define it, or what would define your legacy? And then we're going to jump into some lyrics. I just want to hear from you all, like, what is legacy for you? Yeah. The preacher's hand. A charge of energy set all the cards back. It took all these years to get to zero. In fact, I hated religion because here was this Christian. He was preaching on Sunday versus how he was living Monday. Someday I forgive him, because strangely our division led to multiple religions. What is that? Brother Percy, come on, speak to this, man. What is it? Yeah. That's sort of like the eighth clause of the text, if you will. Talks about whose daughter couldn't escape the reach of the preacher's hand, which is clearly saying that his granddad molested his aunt, right? Because it's his father's dad, and it says his daughter couldn't escape the reach of the preacher's hand. And so what Jay-Z does is that he equates the sins of the grandfather, right? The sins of the grandfather who, in turn, held an entire, not like two, but three generations back, right? It held him back, and it said that it changed, that charge of energy set all the Carters back. Now here's what's interesting. He says, it took all these years to get to zero. Not it took all these years to get to 100, not to 50. Like, he's saying at this point, from his granddad's mistakes, how many other years ago that was, it took him that amount of time, and he's just at zero. Now, we know, I'm sure some other people here who know mathematics and know well, but, you know, if you're dealing with integers, right, you know, you're dealing with negative numbers, and then it takes some time for you to get to zero, right? I mean, there's a span, but then when you get to zero, you still have nothing, right? So it's interesting because, like, Jay-Z is actually saying, like, even all that, he comes to a place where he's still at zero. Now, in our society, we look at zero as being a bad place to be because it's saying you start with nothing. But what Jay-Z does is actually like the best place to be, because it gave him a landscape to be able to explore to determine what his faith would ultimately be. That's yet, right? Because then he says, then he takes us through the journey that it took for him to get to zero. Look what it says. It says, it took all these years just to get to zero. Because he said, I hate it. Hated is past tense. So that's how we know he's talking about the past. That's not where he is, right? So he says, I hated religion because here was this Christian. He was preaching on Sundays versus how he was living on Monday. Someday, I forgive him. Right? He did forgive him. He says, because strangely, I have a vision led to multiple religions. He said this, I study Muslim, Buddhist, and Christian. Study Muslim, Buddhist, and Christian. How many of you want to study multiple religions? It's good. That's powerful. All right. I'm going to tell you why. Like, you know, as a Christian preacher, as a pastor, and a person who's been charged to help shape and guide and try to lead young adults down a path that's Christian, I too have studied multiple religions. One of the most beautiful experiences that I had while going to divinity school was that it was divinity school. It wasn't seminary. There's a difference. Seminary is the place where you literally learn about your faith for the most part. Divinity school is where you learn all about that which is considered divine. So I had an opportunity to go, and not just, it's different.